The aircraft of today are quieter, more efficient, and stronger than anyone could have imagined, even a few short years ago. Of course, future aircraft will continue this trend and become even more efficient and dependable, reaching unimaginable goals that today's aircraft could never reach. But how will they reach these goals? And who is performing the important work to change the way we all fly? The common misconception is that most advances come strictly from major aircraft manufacturers. But the true story is much more complex. Unknown to most of the public is that one of the unsung leaders in aviation is NASA. NASA engineers, who work hand in hand with industry planners, developing and testing new designs to make aircraft safer, greener, and much more efficient. On this episode of NASA X, we will look at how this collaboration works, and we'll see how NASA and industry are paving the way for greener, safer aircraft for today and for aircraft of the future as well. This is a familiar sight for modern travelers. Large metal jets roaring down the runway and lifting into the air. In fact, this sight really hasn't changed that much in the last 50 years or so. Other than the way most people dressed for flights back then, the basic concept of air travel is pretty much the same. There have, of course, been measurable differences in fuel economy, with new developments in engine design and noise reduction techniques. But the basic tube and wing shape and the material used to build these aircraft has remained pretty much the same for years. But that isn't the case anymore. Like so many products that have evolved dramatically in the last few decades, like phones for example, the same is true for aircraft design. Today, more than ever, researchers are pushing the boundaries of the science of flight in their effort to make aircraft of the future more efficient, quieter, and greener. So who's taking the lead and why? Obviously, industry is taking the lead in some areas because cleaner operations and more efficiency mean higher profits. But they're just not the only players. One of the leading innovators in aeronautics over the history of flight has been and continues to be NASA. The push to modernize and change aircraft of the future is being led by NASA's Environmentally Responsible Aviation Project, or ERA. The ERA project is putting its money where its mouth is with tough but reachable goals to make big changes in how we fly by the year 2025.
So the Environmentally Responsible Aviation Project is a six-year project, and it's focused on advanced aircraft design and the technologies that are needed to enable them. The main goal of the project is to reduce noise, to reduce mission fuel burn, and to reduce LTO NOx emissions. And LTO stands for landing takeoff, oxides of nitrogen emissions. And we want to do that simultaneously, and that's never been done before, where we looked at some very difficult metrics and tried to push all of those metrics down simultaneously. And so over this 5 or 6 years, we'll be looking at technologies, we'll be looking at aircraft designs and the combination of those to end up with a configuration that could simultaneously attack these goals.
So how do you make these goals a reality? The four basic principles of flight are lift, drag, weight, and thrust. Finding efficiency in each of these basic principles will help reach NASA's stated goals. Let's look at weight first. Obviously, if you can reduce the weight of an aircraft, then you will burn less fuel and therefore become more efficient. Airlines are always looking for ways to carry less weight. You can see that in extra baggage fees, reduction of heavy items such as ovens and heavy carts on some planes. And in one of the most drastic measures taken in recent years, some airlines have begun asking passengers to use the bathroom in the terminal before getting on the plane, making the passengers a little lighter. In a one-month experiment, an airline found that they reduced greenhouse gas by 5 tons, simply by asking passengers to use the loo ahead of time. This proves that even small changes in the weight of an aircraft can add up to big, long-term benefits. The holy grail, of course, is to make the entire aircraft structure lighter. So how can this be done? Today's aircraft are made out of metals that are safe, but that are also very heavy. So is there an alternative? In recent decades, NASA and its industry partners have been working hard developing new materials that could bring aircraft out of the 20th century and into the future. New composite materials are leading the charge to replace conventional metals. Aircraft designers are taking advantage of composite materials' lightweight, strength, and flexibility. Aircraft designers have long known about these qualities and have been using something called carbon epoxy composite materials in small quantities for decades. After years of research and validation of composites for flight, the Boeing company was the first to step up and build an aircraft almost completely out of composite materials. Called the 787, this next generation aircraft first came into service in November of 2011. As the first official commercial flight of the 787 took off from Tokyo that year, it was clear that this concept of an all-composite aircraft was here to stay. NASA is not in the business of building aircraft, but they are in the business of helping lead development programs to move the science of flight along. Once validation and testing in the development process is complete, NASA shares its findings with industry in an attempt to help further research and development. One of the programs in which NASA is working with industry is in the development of new composite materials for aircraft. Here in the Structures and Materials Lab in Building 1148 at NASA Langley Research Center, much of the development of next generation composites for use in aircraft is taking shape. Called Perseus, this new idea has the potential to completely rewrite how composites for use in aircraft are made. Leading much of the research for NASA's Environmentally Responsible Aviation Program in the composite field is NASA Langley's Dawn Jegley. This MIT grad has been working with these materials for decades and has a keen understanding of what needs to be done to make these composites of the future fly.
Perseus stands for Protruded Rod Stitched Efficient Unitized Structure. And what that means is that we have a graphite epoxy or a carbon epoxy structure, and what we have is protruded rods inside carbon layers. We have a carbon skin, and we have stitches that run through the thickness that holds the whole thing together.
One of the huge benefits associated with Perseus is its revolutionary stitching technique. On current metal and composite aircraft, one of the key components used to hold the vehicle together are the fasteners, like rivets or bolts. Although these are effective, one major drawback is that quite a few holes have to be drilled into each piece where the fasteners will be added. Not only is that labor intensive, but each hole represents a place where damage or a crack could start. But the stitching prevents that from happening.
We found that if you have a crack and it grows to a certain point and it gets to some place that it's stitched, that crack will turn. So instead of going through the stitching, it will turn. And that's a good thing, because in flight, you would rather not have a crack grow all the way around a wing.
When you look at a piece of carbon epoxy composite material, it honestly doesn't look very strong in its raw form. But once it is in its final state, it can be much stronger than metals.
We start out with a fabric. It looks kind of like carpeting. And you roll that out into the shape that you're looking for, and you position all the different parts of your structure where you want them, and then you come through with a stitching machine. After you've stitched the whole thing together, the panel goes into an oven. It's infused with epoxy. We heat it up, and then we get everything just the way we want it, and then we cool the structure. So what happens is you end up with a piece of material, could be a very large piece of material, which is now stiff and strong and just in the right shape that you want it.
Another key component to carbon epoxy composite materials is that they can be tailored to be much stronger than metal. At the molecular level, the properties of metal are isotropic, which means that the properties all run in the same direction. Because of this feature, aircraft designs are very bulky in some areas to provide stiffness, making a craft much heavier. But with composites, you are starting with fibers, which are very strong, tough threads, and you can position those threads in any direction you want. For example, If there is an area on the aircraft that takes a lot of load, the designers can place the fibers in that direction, providing enormous strength, but while also using much less material and weight than metal aircraft. Of course, validating that the pieces will work is a major component of the development stage.
So I know that NASA really does some great testing of its materials before they go onto any aircraft. How are you testing Perseus at the moment?
One of NASA's goals is to develop technology for future aircraft. When we're developing a new structure, one of the things we need to do is fully understand how it's going to behave. And to do that, we start by looking at very small pieces, and then we move up slowly to very large pieces until we get to a full-scale part of an aircraft. And then when we understand that, we go to the next stage, which might be something more like this, where we have what we call a built-up structure. So we have a skin, and then we have a stiffener on it. And then we can apply a load. We might push on it, we might pull on it, we might bend it to look at how that behaves. And all the while we're doing this, we're doing analytical studies to make sure we understand and can predict how it's going to behave. Because if we don't predict it properly, then we feel we don't really understand it well enough, and we have to take a step back and figure out what it is we're missing. We have many facilities around the center here that we use for doing those kind of tests.
Well, Dawn, thanks so much for talking to us today about Perseus. This looks like an amazing technology, and you're doing a fantastic job. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Up next, let's look at another of the basic principles of flight, thrust. Since the earliest days of flight, engineers have looked for ways to make the engines we use on aircraft more powerful and efficient. One of the most important early engines was the 1903 Wright Brother design that was used for their very first flight at Kitty Hawk. It only produced about 12 horsepower, but it opened the door for all aircraft engines to come. Since that time, there has been a steady progression in the development of engine technology, from the relatively simple propellers of the past to the incredibly advanced jet propulsors of today. Engines have never been better, but although current engines are already very efficient, quiet, and relatively green, they pale in comparison to what the next generation of engine technology will be. To help understand how engine technology is improving, let's first take a look at how a basic turbofan engine works. Incoming air is captured in the engine inlet. Some of the air passes through the fan and into the compressor and burner, where it is mixed with fuel for combustion. The hot exhaust passes through the core and fan turbines and then out of the nozzle. The rest of the incoming air passes through the fan and bypasses or goes around the engine. So a turbofan gets some of its thrust from the core and some of its thrust from the fan. The ratio of the air that goes around the engine to the air that goes through the core is called the bypass ratio. Many engines today have a bypass ratio of roughly around 5 to 1. Engineers have known for many years that if they could increase the bypass ratio, then the engine would become much more efficient. But the trouble with increasing the bypass means that the size of the engine would have to grow, making it heavier and also unable to fit under the wings of most planes. So, what to do? Over the past 20 years or so, NASA and industry have been working on a solution that would create ultra-high bypass engines while also addressing the stated problems of size and weight. Today, a new engine designed in collaboration with Pratt & Whitney and NASA has been developed that will more than double the bypass of current engines. This new engine design has taken many years of research and development just to get to the point where we are today, because three key pieces of technology needed to be created that didn't exist. A new gearing system, an ultra-efficient fan, and a more efficient nacelle. Although each of these were difficult to perfect, one of the most challenging was the gearing system for the turbofan. This is because there is a paradox in engine design. The slower the big fan at the front moves, the more efficient it is. But the turbines at the back have to move at a very high rate of speed to work efficiently, hence the paradox. In order to have the slow-moving fan at the front and the fast-moving fans at the back working together, a revolutionary gear system had to be developed that could allow both of these parts to work together optimally.
So what the gear lets me do is shrink the core engine that makes the power to a large degree. It makes it lighter. It makes takes a couple of thousand parts out. And it means I can replace some very rare super alloys with some more common gear steel. We always knew you could do that, but you need a gear that's way over 99% efficient. You need a gear that, we're talking about 25,000, 30,000 horsepower gears. A naval ship has that sort of power, and the gear is the size of a small house. We had to develop a gear that's the size of a small automobile wheel, not a house, and it has to last 20 years without maintenance, and it has to be super efficient. And so we've been working on this for at least 20 years.
Much of the testing for this engine has in fact come at NASA laboratories. NASA's unique facilities and subject matter experts have helped the Pratt & Whitney team to understand how to configure the ultra-high bypass engine.
So this is an example of the ultra-high bypass engine from Pratt & Whitney called the Geared Turbofan. This particular engine has a bypass ratio of up to 15 to 1, which means 15 times the amount of air goes through this part of it than goes through this part. This is the core, or the engine part. This is the bypass part. In this particular engine, all the thrust is generated in this part, and we've removed the fan so that you can see how small the engine airflow is compared to the overall flow. So why? Why do we want to do this? Well, this particular design, especially the one Pratt & Whitney is working on called the Geared Turbofan, has a potential of having as much as 20% better fuel burn than a regular jet engine today. And the reason they can do that is because the more air that you can put up here, the more efficient the engine is and the better the fuel economy.
Because fuel costs have spiraled out of control in recent years, the fuel efficiency of this engine could be a game changer for the aircraft industry.
The people who care are not so much Airbus, but their customers, the airlines. So an A320 with these engines on compared to the current engines will make $200 to $400 an hour, on the order of $1.5 to $2.5 million a year reduced fuel cost, depending upon the cost of fuel, typically. So it's worth millions per year for the airline. That doesn't mean they still won't charge you for the extra bag, though.
Of course, fuel economy is not the only huge benefit to this engine. Its noise reduction capability is truly astounding. On a typical jet aircraft, the fans at the front are moving at more than the speed of sound, making them very noisy. But because this new engine's forward fans move slower, they now make much, much less noise.
They are really quiet. How quiet is really quiet? For a 737 size airplane, 150 passenger airplane, the objectionable noise on the ground, the area that hears objectionable noise, is reduced by about 3/4. Almost to the NASA goal, which is to keep it in the airport.
Another key component in the testing chain of the entire engine happens here at NASA Glenn, in the Advanced Subsonic Combustion Rig, or ASCR. This facility is the only one in the country that allows real-time, real-world testing conditions for engine combustors.
This is the Advanced Subsonic Combustor Rig. It's really one of the unique facilities in the U.S. which enables us to test combustors and gas turbine engines at realistic conditions that they would see in a gas turbine engine flying in today's aircraft and even those in the next 20 years from now. The real beauty of this rig is it allows us to operate pretty much over the whole flight regime. So we can map out how much what the emissions are near the ground during idle and takeoff conditions, but also on approach and landing, in addition then even at cruise, because we're also becoming more and more concerned about emissions in the atmosphere and what that does to our environment.
The environment is one of the key components in much of the work going on now. NASA and industry realize that good stewardship is not only beneficial to the planet, but can be a good business model too. The work that is coming out of this program is looking at both fuel flexible applications as well as strictly environmental concerns.
Our geared turbofan is 15% more efficient and can run on a wide range of fuels. In fact, we're some of the leaders working with the industry in the development of biofuels.
Of course, testing for these new engines is not only happening at NASA, but can also be seen on a unique airplane owned by Pratt & Whitney.
Pratt & Whitney actually owns two 747 airplanes that we do testing on. There are four engines on a 747. We'll actually take one of the existing JT9Ds off, which is a Pratt & Whitney made engine that powers 747s, and we'll actually, in some cases, replace that engine with one of our test engines. So we'll run the airplane on four engines, three of which are currently certified on the airplane, the fourth being the experimental.
Of course, this new geared turbofan is not the only game in town. NASA has also taken a look back at some older technology, including a concept called the open rotor that also shows much promise.
So here at NASA, we're working on the next generation of engine technologies, both ducted engines like the geared turbofan and unducted engines like open rotors. So we recently finished a series of tests with General Electric and the Federal Aviation Administration on open rotors, looking at these technologies to reduce fuel burn and improve the acoustic performance of these next generation engines. So as you try to go to higher and higher bypass ratio engines, the fans keep getting larger and larger diameter, and at some point it just makes sense to get rid of the cowling and go with just what essentially looks like a propeller. The difference is that these are very specialized high-speed propellers, so that an open rotor powered aircraft would be able to fly at essentially the same speed as an aircraft with a jet engine.
In the past, the open rotor concept had been promising, but the major drawback was the noise. Thanks to the advent of modern computational fluid dynamics, NASA and industry engineers have been able to redesign the blades for these open rotors and make them much, much quieter.
The system studies that NASA's done has shown that for single aisle aircraft, if we built an open rotor engine today and put it on an aircraft, it would probably be quieter than most of the aircraft that are flying out there right now. So we've come a long, long way in being able to solve the acoustics issues that were part of the original unducted rotor program.
So there you have it. NASA's ERA program and industry are truly changing the way we all fly. NASA is pushing the industry hard to make these changes see the light of day. And industry is responding with truly innovative and groundbreaking technologies.
With this type of collaboration and work ethic, there's no doubt the world will soon see a dramatic difference in the way we all fly. I'm Vince Whitfield, and we'll see you next time on NASA X. The aircraft of today are quieter, more efficient, and stronger than anyone could have imagined, even a few short years ago. Of course, future aircraft will continue this trend and become even more efficient and dependable, reaching unimaginable goals that today's aircraft could never reach. But how will they reach these goals, and who is performing the important work to change the way we all fly? The common misconception is that most advances come strictly from major aircraft manufacturers. But the true story is much more complex. Unknown to most of the public is that one of the unsung leaders in aviation is NASA. NASA engineers, who work hand in hand with industry planners,
developing and testing new designs to make aircraft safer, greener, and much more efficient. On this episode of NASA X, we will look at how this collaboration works, and we'll see how NASA and industry are paving the way for greener, safer aircraft for today and for aircraft of the future as well. This is a familiar sight for modern travelers. Large metal jets roaring down the runway and lifting into the air. In fact, this sight really hasn't changed that much in the last 50 years or so. Other than the way most people dressed for flights back then, the basic concept of air travel is pretty much the same. There have, of course, been measurable differences in fuel economy, with new developments in engine design and noise reduction techniques. But the basic tube and wing shape and the material used to build these aircraft has remained pretty much the same for years. But that isn't the case anymore. Like so many products that have evolved dramatically in the last few decades, like phones for example, the same is true for aircraft design. Today, more than ever, researchers are pushing the boundaries of the science of flight in their effort to make aircraft of the future more efficient, quieter, and greener.
So who's taking the lead and why? Obviously, industry is taking the lead in some areas because cleaner operations and more efficiency mean higher profits. But they're just not the only players.
One of the leading innovators in aeronautics over the history of flight has been and continues to be NASA. The push to modernize and change aircraft of the future is being led by NASA's Environmentally Responsible Aviation Project, or ERA. The ERA project is putting its money where its mouth is with tough but reachable goals to make big changes in how we fly by the year 2025.
So the Environmentally Responsible Aviation Project is a five-year, six-year project, and it's focused on advanced aircraft design and the technologies that are needed to enable them. The main goal of the project is to reduce noise, to reduce mission fuel burn, and to reduce LTO NOx emissions. And LTO stands for landing takeoff, oxides of nitrogen emissions. And we want to do that simultaneously, and that's never been done before, where we looked at some very difficult metrics and tried to push all of those metrics down simultaneously. And so over this 5 or 6 years, we'll be looking at technologies, we'll be looking at aircraft designs and the combination of those to end up with a configuration that could simultaneously attack these goals.
So how do you make these goals a reality? The four basic principles of flight are lift, drag, weight, and thrust. Finding efficiency in each of these basic principles will help reach NASA's stated goals. Let's look at weight first. Obviously, if you can reduce the weight of an aircraft, then you will burn less fuel and therefore become more efficient. Airlines are always looking for ways to carry less weight. You can see that in extra baggage fees, reduction of heavy items such as ovens and heavy carts on some planes. And in one of the most drastic measures taken in recent years, some airlines have begun asking passengers to use the bathroom in the terminal before getting on the plane, making the passengers a little lighter. In the 1 month experiment, an airline found that they reduced greenhouse gas by 5 tons, simply by asking passengers to use a loo ahead of time. This proves that even small changes in the weight of an aircraft can add up to big long-term benefits. The holy grail, of course, is to make the entire aircraft structure lighter. So how can this be done? Today's aircraft are made out of metals that are safe, but that are also very heavy. So is there an alternative? In recent decades, NASA and its industry partners have been working hard developing new materials that could bring aircraft out of the 20th century and into the future. New composite materials are leading the charge to replace conventional metals. Aircraft designers are taking advantage of composite materials' lightweight, strength, and flexibility. Aircraft designers have long known about these qualities and have been using something called carbon epoxy composite materials in small quantities for decades. After years of research and validation of composites for flight, the Boeing company was the first to step up and build an aircraft almost completely out of composite materials. Called the 787, this next generation aircraft first came into service in November of 2011. As the first official commercial flight of the 787 took off from Tokyo that year, it was clear that this concept of an all-composite aircraft was here to stay. NASA is not in the business of building aircraft, but they are in the business of helping lead development programs to move the science of flight along. Once validation and testing in the development process is complete, NASA shares its findings with industry in an attempt to help further research and development. One of the programs in which NASA is working with industry is in the development of new composite materials for aircraft. Here in the Structures and Materials Lab in Building 1148 at NASA Langley Research Center, much of the development of next generation composites for use in aircraft is taking shape. Called Perseus, this new idea has the potential to completely rewrite how composites for use in aircraft are made. Leading much of the research for NASA's Environmentally Responsible Aviation Program in the composite field is NASA Langley's Dawn Jegley. This MIT grad has been working with these materials for decades and has a keen understanding of what needs to be done to make these composites of the future fly.
Perseus stands for Protruded Rod Stitched Efficient Unitized Structure. And what that means is that we have a graphite epoxy or a carbon epoxy structure, and what we have is protruded rods inside carbon layers. We have a carbon skin, and we have stitches that run through the thickness that holds the whole thing together.
One of the huge benefits associated with Perseus is its revolutionary stitching technique. On current metal and composite aircraft, one of the key components used to hold the vehicle together are the fasteners, like rivets or bolts. Although these are effective, one major drawback is that quite a few holes have to be drilled into each piece where the fasteners will be added. Not only is that labor intensive, but each hole represents a place where damage or a crack could start. But the stitching prevents that from happening.
We found that if you have a crack and it grows to a certain point and it gets to some place that it's stitched, that crack will turn. So instead of going through the stitching, it will turn. And that's a good thing, because in flight, you would rather not have a crack grow all the way around a wing.
When you look at a piece of carbon epoxy composite material, it honestly doesn't look very strong in its raw form, but once it is in its final state, it can be much stronger than metals.
We start out with a fabric. It looks kind of like carpeting. And you roll that out into the shape that you're looking for, and you position all the different parts of your structure where you want them, and then you come through with a stitching machine. After you've stitched the whole thing together, the panel goes into an oven. It's infused with epoxy. We heat it up, and then we get everything just the way we want it, and then we cool the structure. So what happens is you end up with a piece of material, could be a very large piece of material, which is now stiff and strong and just in the right shape that you want it.
Another key component to carbon epoxy composite materials is that they can be tailored to be much stronger than metal. At the molecular level, the properties of metal are isotropic, which means that the properties all run in the same direction. Because of this feature, aircraft designs are very bulky in some areas to provide stiffness, making a craft much heavier. But with composites, you are starting with fibers, which are very strong, tough threads, and you can position those threads in any direction you want. For example, if there is an area on the aircraft that takes a lot of load, the designers can place the fibers in that direction, providing enormous strength, but while also using much less material and weight than metal aircraft. Of course, validating that the pieces will work is a major component of the development stage.
So I know that NASA really does some great testing of its materials before they go onto any aircraft. How are you testing Perseus at the moment?
One of NASA's goals is to develop technology for future aircraft. When we're developing a new structure, one of the things we need to do is fully understand how it's going to behave. And to do that, we start by looking at very small pieces, and then we move up slowly to very large pieces until we get to a full-scale part of an aircraft. And then when we understand that, we go to the next stage, which might be something more like this, where we have a what we call a built-up structure. So we have a skin, and then we have a stiffener on it. And then we can apply a load. We might push on it, we might pull on it, we might bend it to look at how that behaves. And all the while we're doing this, we're doing analytical studies to make sure we understand and can predict how it's going to behave. Because if we don't predict it properly, then we feel we don't really understand it well enough, and we have to take a step back and figure out what it is we're missing. We have many facilities around the center here that we use for doing those kind of tests.
Well, Dawn, thanks so much for talking to us today about Perseus. This looks like an amazing technology, and you're doing a fantastic job. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Up next, let's look at another of the basic principles of flight, thrust. Since the earliest days of flight, engineers have looked for ways to make the engines we use on aircraft more powerful and efficient. One of the most important early engines was the 1903 Wright Brother design that was used for their very first flight at Kitty Hawk. It only produced about 12 horsepower, but it opened the door for all aircraft engines to come. Since that time, there has been a steady progression in the development of engine technology, from the relatively simple propellers of the past to the incredibly advanced jet propulsors of today. Engines have never been better, but although current engines are already very efficient, quiet, and relatively green, they pale in comparison to what the next generation of engine technology will be. To help understand how engine technology is improving, let's first take a look at how a basic turbofan engine works. Incoming air is captured in the engine inlet. Some of the air passes through the fan and into the compressor and burner, where it is mixed with fuel for combustion. The hot exhaust passes through the core and fan turbines and then out of the nozzle. The rest of the incoming air passes through the fan and bypasses or goes around the engine. So a turbofan gets some of its thrust from the core and some of its thrust from the fan. The ratio of the air that goes around the engine to the air that goes through the core is called the bypass ratio. Many engines today have a bypass ratio of roughly around 5 to 1. Engineers have known for many years that if they could increase the bypass ratio, then the engine would become much more efficient. But the trouble with increasing the bypass means that the size of the engine would have to grow, making it heavier and also unable to fit under the wings of most planes. So, what to do? Over the past 20 years or so, NASA and industry have been working on a solution that would create ultra-high bypass engines while also addressing the stated problems of size and weight. Today, a new engine designed in collaboration with Pratt & Whitney and NASA has been developed that will more than double the bypass of current engines. This new engine design has taken many years of research and development just to get to the point where we are today, because three key pieces of technology needed to be created that didn't exist: a new gearing system, an ultra-efficient fan, and a more efficient nacelle. Although each of these were difficult to perfect, one of the most challenging was the gearing system for the turbofan. This is because there is a paradox in engine design. The slower the big fan at the front moves, the more efficient it is, but the turbines at the back have to move at a very high rate of speed to work efficiently, hence the paradox. In order to have the slow-moving fan at the front and the fast-moving fans at the back working together, a revolutionary gear system had to be developed that could allow both of these parts to work together optimally.
So what the gear lets me do is shrink the core engine that makes the power to a large degree. It makes it lighter, it takes a couple of thousand parts out, and it means I can replace some very rare super alloys with some more common gear steel. We always knew you could do that, but you need a gear that's way over 99% efficient. You need a gear that, we're talking about 25,000, 30,000 horsepower gears. A naval ship has that sort of power, and the gear is the size of a small house. We had to develop a gear that's the size of a small automobile wheel, not a house, and it has to last 20 years without maintenance, and it has to be super efficient. And so we've been working on this for at least 20 years.
Much of the testing for this engine has in fact come at NASA laboratories. NASA's unique facilities and subject matter experts have helped the Pratt & Whitney team to understand how to configure the ultra-high bypass engine.
So this is an example of the ultra-high bypass engine from Pratt & Whitney called the geared turbofan. This particular engine has a bypass ratio of up to 15 to 1, which means 15 times the amount of air goes through this part of it and goes through this part. This is the core, or the engine part. This is the bypass part. In this particular engine, all the thrust is generated in this part, and we've removed the fan so that you can see how small the engine airflow is compared to the overall flow. So why? Why do we want to do this? Well, this particular design, especially the one Pratt & Whitney is working on called the geared turbofan, has a potential of having as much as 20% fuel, better fuel burn than a regular jet engine today. And the reason they can do that is because the more air that you can put up here, the more efficient the engine is and the better the fuel economy.
Because fuel costs have spiraled out of control in recent years, the fuel efficiency of this engine could be a game changer for the aircraft industry.
The people who care are not so much Airbus, but their customers, the airlines. So an A320 with these engines on compared to the current engines will make $200 to $400 an hour, on the order of $1.5 to $2.5 million a year reduced fuel cost, depending upon the cost of fuel, typically. So it's worth millions per year for the airline. That doesn't mean they still won't charge you for the extra bag, though.
Of course, fuel economy is not the only huge benefit to this engine. Its noise reduction capability is truly astounding. On a typical jet aircraft, the fans at the front are moving at more than the speed of sound, making them very noisy. But because this new engine's forward fans move slower, they now make much, much less noise.
They are really quiet. And how quiet is really quiet? For a 737 size airplane, 150 passenger airplane, the objectionable noise on the ground, the area that hears objectionable noise, is reduced by about 3/4. Almost to the NASA goal, which is to keep it in the airport.
Another key component in the testing chain of the entire engine happens here at NASA Glenn, in the Advanced Subsonic Combustion Rig, or ASCR. This facility is the only one in the country that allows real-time, real-world testing conditions for engine combustors.
This is the Advanced Subsonic Combustor Rig. It's really one of the unique facilities in the U.S. which enables us to test combustors and gas turbine engines at realistic conditions that they would see in a gas turbine engine flying in today's aircraft and even those in the next 20 years from now. The real beauty of this rig is it allows us to operate pretty much over the whole flight regime. So we can map out how much, what the emissions are near the ground during idle and takeoff conditions, but also on approach and landing, in addition then even at cruise, because we're also becoming more and more concerned about emissions in the atmosphere and what that does to our environment.
The environment is one of the key components in much of the work going on now. NASA